yeah, so Eric is now there, and yeah, that'll be fun to see them do. So this is the chuck rib plate, and as I was saying, we use this for kalbi or flanken, and we do that because this is all meat. And if you think of what a short rib looks like, it's meat, fat, meat, fat, meat, fat, big, big chunks of fat. So we like this for grilling cuts because there's just more meat. And down here, this is that breastbone I was telling you about. And I assume this is okay, but just to show you that this is cartilage. You actually have cartilage right here too. So the kind of a creepy slash awesome thing about doing butchery is that we're all pretty much built like this animal, just a lot smaller. So I can actually cut right between, of course now I can't find it, there it is. I can cut right between these rib tips, and this is just cartilage between there and your backbone. So if you ever, sometimes you'll feel something pop right here, that's because you're just cartilage right there too. So you can come right across if you want. Again, this is not something anyone would ever do in real life, but there you go.
So you can kind of scoring.
This is like a super inefficient way. Like this is just to show you that these tips are just cartilage, right there. So that's that. So now we're left with our chuck roll, which is attached to the neck, and we have a brisket, and we have all the fun little stuff underneath. So I'm gonna pretty quickly just take off this whole chuck, take off the whole brisket, and then we'll see the little stuff. So.
Just to give you time check, Sam,
yeah.
It's 10:37.
Okay, does that mean I'm way over already?
A little bit,
okay.
That way.
I'll go fast.
Which is, I mentioned, no, because I think it's a good idea for us to ask questions as we have them. We might have a little bit less time than we thought. We will have a little bit less time than we thought for just a short Q&A session. If that's okay, so ask a question while you're
waiting. Yeah. I'll move a little faster too.
Sam, you'll probably get to this when you're doing the shank, but you mentioned earlier you don't want to put the shank in the ground. So what's your preferred use for the shank?
Dog food.
If you don't have anyone that wants shank,
Sometimes restaurants will do an osso buco, but with beef. But this shank is not great for that because it's got two bones. The rear shank only has the one bone, so it's like a very beautiful presentation. Mm-hmm. This one's a little bit less appealing.
I've had customers ask for shank bones.
Yeah.
So you can't do is use the bones for broth.
From a beef? From beef animals?
Or
from,
yeah.
Then you can use them for broth, sure. You are, as I said, with the marrow bone though, you're just gonna get a lot of fat. And then you're just gonna skim that off at the end. So what's the point? Okay, so one thing that's different that I'm doing here is this is the shoulder blade, the paddle bone, and so I'm scraping it to try to get, if you can get under the bone skin, as it's called, which is covering the bone, you can have a much, much cleaner seam than if you just try to stay on top of that bone skin. So I'm taking off this entire chuck with the neck attached, which will give these guys options for doing whatever it is they want to do with it.
So if this were being done in the teen style that you described mm-hmm. earlier, how would it be broken? How would the tasks be broken down?
So this chuck neck combo would have been broken off first, probably, and it would have been broken off from the flip side, where they would have come down the backside of the paddle bone, of the shoulder blade, and they would have basically broken off everything. They would have cut it in half, essentially, but from the reverse side. So all of this would go one way, and then what we're about to be left with would go another way.
To a different group of people, or different butchers?
Sorry?
These would be done by different teams of...
Yeah, I mean, we only have... So despite the fact that we have five butcher shops, we at our central commissary, we only have 4 full-time butchers. So they break all of the animals for all five shops, and the kind of the that just speaks to the importance of the added efficiency to having a facility where all they're doing is breaking. They don't have to take breaks to help customers or anything like that.
Would they specialize in different parts of each butcher?
No, they switch off. We don't want them, any of them, to get repetitive stress or anything like that. So they
And working in teams of two?
No, they all, the whole team of four mm-hmm. will work together, generally speaking. So this is the chuck. Let me cut off this piece that I mangled earlier. Okay, so if you were to talk about a square cut chuck, it would pretty much just be this block right here. And then this is the neck, which we would this time of year use for a stew. The neck's delicious, the neck's awesome. It looks a little gnarly, but it's great.
You said this time of year, what do you use it for?
In the summer, it's ground beef. Oh. Yeah, just more ground beef. And then this, which is a continuation of that chuck rib muscle, we cut into a great steak known as the Denver steak. Speaking of women, Carrie Underley has popularized a lot of these cuts off of the chuck, and she's a big fan of the Denver steak. We're a big fan of the Denver steak. So basically this muzzle that we cut up into steaks. Other things you can do off of this, which I'm not gonna get into because of time, is these first cuts off of this chuck roll are just ribeyes, really. And as long as they have this muscle, this is the same muscle that is in the ribeye and the New York strip, they make for a pretty good eaten steak. If that gets smaller and smaller, it gets less and less tender. So we already cut off one that's still on the rib, but you could probably get one more, what we call chuck ribeye, off of this. And then the rest of it's just gonna be a chuck roast, which is gonna be a pot roast, basically. It's your classic pot roast. All right, so I'm gonna leave that.
When I was growing up, chuck was just considered sort of like so low end.
Mm-hmm.
Just do other people remember that? No, like,
yeah.
Yeah? Yeah. Was that a marketing thing, do you think, by like the Beef Association? Or, I mean, what? Because there's...
I think it still is.
Still is what?
It's still considered really low value.
Yeah.
And economical.
Yeah.
Economical.
I think, you know, it's thanks to people like Thomas Keller who came out and taught people that short ribs had value if you cooked them right, that now short ribs, I mean, I think short ribs would have mostly been grind for a lot of years or pastrami roll or something, where now they're more sought after, just like the hanger steak. We have an old school shop around the corner here that we send people to when we don't have enough. We get 3/4 of a pound of hanger steak a week.
So
if somebody says we need 5 pounds, we send them over there. And for a long time, the cutters there would laugh at the people because they couldn't believe that anybody would want a hanger steak. Like, that's a grind cut.
But some of it was importing cuts from Europe or adopting European cuts, I think. Is that right?
Partly, but also going back to things that were merchandised here, like culotte and bobette are cuts that Americans didn't know for a long time. Mm-hmm. It's not that those were purely European. They were here for a long time, but once you get into the USDA cut schemes, then those just weren't included in the cuts because, again, people weren't asking for them, so they fell out of favor.
Is it work to get people to buy a chuck roast or a chuck ribeye?
Sometimes. We find that, and this has, you have to train your staff appropriately, but you have to kind of play the long game. Like the first time someone comes into a shop like Fleischer's, it's because they've heard we have the best meat and they're having their in-laws over and they just want a tenderloin or a ribeye.
Right.
There's no way you're gonna convince them that they're not getting a tenderloin or a ribeye. Mm-hmm. But hopefully, as Ben was saying, you know, your number one goal is for it to be delicious, right? Because if it's delicious, they're gonna come back. And I think for those of us who are in the sustainability vein of work, you can't be too obsessed with pushing your vision of what sustainability is from the first time they walk in that store, because unfortunately chances are they didn't walk in because you're sustainable. They walked in because they heard your meat's delicious. So you have to let them walk in for that reason. You crush it with your meats. I mean, happily, the better you treat an animal, the more delicious it's going to be. So hopefully they take it home. It's the best thing they've ever had. And then maybe the second, third, fourth, fifth time they come in, they'll come in asking for tenderloin. You ask them what they're doing with it. They say stir fry. And you say, you say, well, could I recommend something else for you? And because they know you and they trust you, then they take your suggestion that time around. But if you're not playing that long game, blood.
And I think places like America's Test Kitchen, who, you know, really doesn't address sustainability stuff at all, but they are all about testing. I mean, over and over and over again, I've seen them do shows where they've tested multiple cuts of meat for a particular dish, and the chuck has ended up being their favorite. Yeah. So it's like, it's definitely, I think there's a sea change happening maybe a little bit just on a more conventional level as well.
And I think the more people that come to shops, like ours or like Fleischer's, the more knowledge they get that a chuck roll, you know, like a chuck roast isn't the same, you know, if you go to a Safeway store and you buy it rolled and under, you know, reduced oxygen packaging than it is when we can merchandise it. Because, you know, when we do, we roll the chuck after we've pulled the chuck eye out, generally for our case, which means you're not getting seven different muscles in the chuck, you're getting three, and they cook a lot more uniformly. And then the other thing we have to benefit us is if somebody doesn't know what a chuck eye is, that's fine. I'm going to cook it, put it on a plate. And then when they ask what that delicious cut was, I say, oh, you can buy it in the case right there. I think for all of us, every small shop, education is key. I mean, that's why we do classes like this. It's why they do classes like this, to try to teach people who didn't have a grandmother, teaching them how to cook different cuts, that it's not terrifying to buy a $35 ribeye. You can do this. Believe in yourself.
So I want to divert us slightly, since I know we're running short on time, and I wanted Patty to come up. She's been taking some notes, watching this, and thinking about how is this different in our shop, you know, based on the things we need to do. So Patty, come on up and tell us what you think.
Yeah, so the one thing the shank, we actually use it in the grind. A lot of times we do take the time to go through and pull off some of those tougher pieces because I wouldn't want to eat it. So that's actually kind of the, we're training our employees is, you know, we're doing somebody's food, obviously a lot more faster than this. The other thing too is we do save a lot of the bones on request. When I do scheduling, a lot of times what we do is we say, okay, it takes us X amount of time to cut a beef, I can schedule this many beef in a day. So your cutting instructions a lot of times depend on how many cuts you get, that kind of stuff. Like I said, we do have the shank to the ground.
We break our beef on the rail, so it was a little bit different to see it done this way. So this is when it's hanging basically on a rail backwards, and we use bandsaws, like she said, it goes a lot faster than old schooling it. Let's see. Oh, the main thing I actually did notice was the cutting into the chuck to pull the rib, to make the rib bigger. In a USDA shop, we actually can't do that. We actually have to label it exactly what it is. They're very actually kind of strict on that. It's called misleading labeling. But in a custom shop, you can definitely do that. So that's one thing to consider. The other thing too is we have different styles of packaging, whether you're doing bone-in or versus boneless. So like the rib where they left it whole like that, we can do bone-in ribeye steaks, but if you're backpacking it, it's generally very unfriendly, especially if it's a frozen product. You'll get unsealed and it ices over and it doesn't look very good to sell it to somebody. But we also do a shrink wrap where you can shrink wrap it, you can throw it on the plate. I say play hockey with it, and then you can eat it for dinner. It's very forgiving. So you got that. Do you guys normally pull the flat irons out of these?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So the other thing too is different cuts. So the chuck is actually a great example of different ways to cut things. We can do a boneless chuck, or if you leave it bone in, you have this whole shoulder blade that we leave in it as well. But you don't get the flat iron steak, which everyone hears about, but you only get 4 per beef or 6 per beef, depending on who you have cutting it. I don't know how many you guys pull.
For what?
Flat iron.
So we'll pull the whole muscle, and then we can usually get 6.
You get 6. That's what we do. We do 6 as well.
Yeah.
So, Let's see. The other thing was the dry aging on ribeyes. In this shop, yeah, we normally do up to 14 days. For us, it's actually cooler capacity. We're a smaller facility, so I can age up to 21 days, but I will charge you for it because it's just that much more space that's being taken up. We generally don't pull primals to just dry age them on themselves. It's kind of we cut your beef on a certain day and then it just goes through our system. We also do pork and lamb, but.
What's the benefit of one versus the other?
I think personally it's marketing. Some people like that 21 day age. They liked it for marketing. It does affect mm-hmm. the flavor. I think your best yield is generally between 10 to 14 days, unless you are just doing a cold cow and grinding it, then there's not overly much benefit unless you're gonna say, yeah, we dry aged it for this long.
And what's the benefit to dry aging it in primals versus just cutting?
If you dry age just one primal, then you're not dry aging the whole thing and taking the loss on the entire carcass.
That is the really key point here, is when you know, sort of the fancy steak restaurants in the old days and places like New York, I mean, they would pull out the specific cuts that would benefit the most from dry aging, and they would have separate dry aging rooms for them and that kind of thing. With a small plant, you know, and actually if you're a producer who has maybe just a few animals, if you're dry aging that whole carcass, sometimes, you know, some people have animals whose carcasses, you know, overall will really benefit from that. But what we see in the majority is that you're taking an awful lot of loss if you're not what? Oh, I'm supposed to use that. You're taking an awful lot of loss when really the dry aging was just benefiting a very small piece of that carcass. And then as Patty said, it's really hard for a small processor who has a limited cooler space. You know, that ends up being the bottleneck sometimes because the animals just aren't coming out. And that's why if you're a producer using a small plant, you need to come and pick up your meat as soon as it's ready, because otherwise you're holding up the show for everybody else. And you know, that's why some processors, and they're real hesitant to do it, will actually charge a little bit, because all of a sudden you're getting free warehousing from them, you know? So they need to keep that space available, so.
Yes, that is very important. I actually walked into my freezer yesterday and went, where did all my space go?
But that's a very common problem.
Very common problem, especially.
However much cooler space you think you need, triple it,
yeah. And the other thing is, it's just that time of year, we got a lot of people coming through. This is the time people are trying to get their stuff off the pasture. They don't want to buy hay for the winter, and so it's just a busy time across the board. But the people who do pick up promptly, I love all of you.
So for custom exempt, do you do custom exempt?
We do very little. We actually have what we call the friends and family list. Basically, I come from a very big family, so I just do it for them. And then we actually do the custom processing for our USDA customers. So if you are one of the people we process USDA for, we will do, you know, your one half you have, whatever. But mainly we just focus on USDA processing.
Does everybody here know what custom exempt is and means? No? Maybe a little explanation of.
And you have it on your little, what are the rules, right? Pass that, but please, you know.
Yeah, so USDA processing means it's done under inspection. So it's killed with a federal employee who's employed by the federal government, USDA, and we process it under inspection. So from 7 to 3:30, we operate under federal hours, which means they are there, they're watching us, we're taking temperatures, we're processing under refrigeration, we're doing all that fun stuff. And it's labeled with what we in the industry call the BUG, which is the USDA stamp of approval. Custom exempt, you need an ODA license in the state of Oregon to process under, which we have, and you can cut it to whenever it says not inspected, not for sale. Generally, the customer themselves is buying the whole animal, giving me the instructions, we cut it to them, they pay the processing and pick it up, home use only. So
let me just add, so the custom exemption is an exemption from the requirements of the Federal Meat Inspection Act. The Federal Meat Inspection Act says all meat must be slaughtered and processed under inspection, and thou shalt have several exemptions, and this is one of them. And this is how people, it was designed for, I just want to have my animal cut up from my own freezer. And now people have used it for selling live animals in advance and doing wholes, halves, and quarters. And if you're a small producer, as someone was, I think you were mentioning, that is a really great way to go, because often those processors are much more available, except when it's hunting season and it's very challenging. So,
Yeah, and what I've seen a lot lately is people are even selling the quarters and halves and they're still having them processed under inspection because of what I've seen. Some people, they're like, I sold it and they backed out and now I have this custom half in my freezer. Mm-hmm. If it's under inspection, you can then sell parts of it, mm-hmm. which is...
Right, and if you're, for anyone who is in the retail business, we cannot sell anything that's not USDA inspected. So, and we have shops in New York State and Connecticut, so in order for me to cross state lines, it also needs to be USDA inspected. So I picked up the pace a little while you were talking.
You know, it's all good.
So just to show you what we would kind of seam out as the last parts of the chuck, the brisket was the first thing I took off. This is one of the biggest muscles on the chuck, and it's kind of how you tell. One of the ways you can tell when an animal's ready for slaughter is they get these big briskets that are kind of like undulating, and that's how you know ready to go. So comes off all as one piece. This is both the flat and the point together. They are two muscles. There's a seam on top here. The fattier part is on top, and that's the point, and that's usually used for smoking or slow roasting. Versus the first cut is the flat, and that is very lean and usually used for pot roasts or that kind of thing. The shoulder clod is, we call it the ranch steak when we slice it against the grain this way. I call it like a weeknight steak. Like, it's nothing fancy, but it's really nice flavor. It's on the leaner side. Right now it's not cleaned up at all. There's several different muscles that are in here and you can separate out more or less of them as you wish. This guy came from the bottom of the shoulder blade, this side of the shoulder blade, and it is the it has been dubbed the Las Vegas Strip. If any of you read that article from Slate about how a new steak has been invented, it's this one. Since it's copyrighted, we can't use that at Fleischer's, so we call it the Atlantic City Strip. But that's what that is. It sits opposite the flat iron, which is this, which came from right in there, the flat iron and the...
we call it the mock tender.
The mock tender, the scotch tender. This is super tough. We don't case this at all at Fleischer's. You can, but not my favorite. And so the flat iron has this big tendon running right through it. It's super, super tough. So your options are either you fillet it on that tendon and you end up with two pieces of meat this size but about this thick, and those are actually the second most tender muscle in the entire animal after the tenderloin, and those are I always suggest the flat iron when someone is coming in for tenderloin and we don't have it and we have to give them something else. I always give them the flat iron because it's got better flavor, just as tender. It's thin, so you only have to cook it for like 4 minutes per side, 3 minutes per side or something, you're done. Love the flat iron. This was sitting right on top of this guy. And this is the, it's called the chuck tender or the bistro filet or...
We call them petite tenders.
Petite tenders.
Yeah, and then we actually refer to this other piece as the cross rib.
Okay, awesome. And so this little guy is also super tender. It's a nice little two-person steak. You cook it whole, we sell it whole. There are a few things. Most of these things we will portion. This is the one thing we do not portion. We also do not portion the skirt steak ever because nobody wants to buy half a skirt steak, except for that one person who wants to buy half a skirt steak.
That person needs to find a friend.
That person needs to find a friend and they can go down the skirt steak together. So
you use a lot of these alternative steaks.
Yeah.
So then you don't have as much hamburger.
Correct. Still a lot, but not as much.
Exactly.
Where do you take most of your ground? Where would we do with it? What part? Well, I mean, so with a shop like ours, it's kind of like a life cycle for any piece of meat. So, and I know that this is not something the USDA loves to hear, especially because they just implemented this new grinding rule for retail butcher shops. But a lot of times what happens is something like this will... go, it'll either get vacuum sealed or wrapped in paper and it'll sit on the shelf till you're ready to cut it for the case. Then you'll slice it into a steak. The steak will look good for maybe 2 days. And if nobody buys it, then you have to decide what you're gonna do with it. And so if you're Ben, you can put it over to your restaurant. sometimes people will grind it, and then so it goes to ground beef. That's not an ideal scenario because you just have meat that you cut on one day, then it's been sitting out, then you just put the outside of that meat inside of itself with your grind. But it is kind of the reality of this meat having a life cycle. You know, another option is sometimes people will, okay, if this doesn't sell as a whole steak, then I'm gonna cut it into cubes and sell it as lean stew. And you can do that to extend the life of things, but only so much, obviously. But every time you cut something and it's exposed to air, you get this bloom from exposing it to oxygen. So it'll light up and get really bright red. And then over time, as it's exposed to more air, it's gonna fade and it's gonna get brown. But oxidation does not necessarily, it's a step on the way to going bad, but just because it's brown doesn't necessarily mean it's bad. In fact, we are very obsessive about our case and about how making sure that everything has a piece of butcher paper, which is treated to prevent oxidation on it. But if you let a piece of red meat touch another piece of red meat, it will turn brown, like just in that spot, just in that one spot where the meat was touching. So you have to be very careful that you're not shortening the actual or saleable life of your product by making it look bad.
Yeah, on our processing side, I get kind of two questions. One, how can I get more ground beef? And two, how can I get less ground beef? So, especially on beef, more often than not, it's how can I get more? For some reason, grass-fed beef is very, ground beef in particular is very popular. Very I think popular. The price points where people can afford to buy it for grass-fed. So I've actually never really had that problem with some of the people we process for. It's always, how can I get more? How can I get more? So I think it's kind of to what your market is. If you're doing farmers markets, if you're looking to do a CSA, you know, the smaller scale, a lot of times ground's the first thing that goes.
Yeah. But.
Also, like if you're processing in the spring for summertime sales, people aren't eating roasts in the summer. So it might behoove you to turn the chuck into grind.
Into grind, yeah. Or make it into patties if you want to have something summery to have a little bit more value added to that to make your yield go up and to increase your, you know, what you make per head.
Can you all talk a little bit about organ meats and parts and what you do with them and what customers are looking for now?
Yeah, a lot of people just say, oh, just cut it up for my dog. Okay.
Yeah.
Liver, a lot of times, especially if it's grass-fed, will sell itself. It's very high in nutrients. So I think a lot of people, there's more literature about it. I'm not sure what you guys do.
It's a major component of our dog food, but we also, there has been a surge in mothers who come in and want, especially if they're iron deficient, they will ask us to blend heart or liver into ground beef for them, which we're happy to do with enough notice.
We have a grind that
is a paleo ground.
Yeah, that's what we have. We have a paleo grind, which is heart and liver.
Oh, that's smart.
Into a grind.
But they don't want to eat them on their own.
Some people do. Some people will come in and ask for it.
I think it makes it a little more palatable. Not that the paleo crowd is necessarily about the palatability.
Yeah. The thing for us for grinding is after for you because we are USDA. If I grind organ meats through our grinder, I have to do a complete grind clean of it before I move on to anything else, which for us is kind of a logistical nightmare. So on a small scale.
Yeah.
If you know, if someone wanted to do 500 to 1,000 pounds, I say, sure, no problem. But other than that, like our minimum on pork sausages is 25 pounds, but even that's kind of a little back and forth.
Yeah, and we have, at our shops, we have a big grinder, like a 250-pound grinder that we do our daily grinds in, but then we also have a smaller tabletop grinder so that we can do custom stuff kind of on demand. That makes the cleaning process a lot less
arduous. Run two of the 250-pounders, and so 25 pounds is about the smallest amount you can get through it while still be able to work with your customers. We do a lot of pork in our shop or our packing facility, and so a lot of people like to have the variety of sausages, smoked and fresh, and plain ground pork. So,
yeah. So from like just personal, what plate size do you use for your grind or like whole size?
We put it through twice, once on a, God, I don't even know what the, once like this and once like that.
We call them chili plate and we call them fine plate, and then I have a sausage plate for our pork customers, so. My husband knows the actual diameter, and one's like 3/8 and one's I don't know what, but
yeah.
You might know.
Three eighths is our basic. We go twice through a 3/8 blade for most of our grinds. But our burger is just one single time through there. We strip all the hard silver out and then just one single time through, and then we hand mix to get the fat distributed. And
right.
How do you measure, like when you're looking at 80-20 or 70-30? Like how exact is that measure?
It depends on
what you're labeling it as. So a packing house will have much. Well, actually, if you put 80-20 on it, it's got to be 80-20
within 2%.
In the butcher shop, we eyeball it, and then about once a quarter, we do have a spectrometer. We will ask each of the shops to send in samples of their grind, and we'll tell them how close they are to 80-20. We always aim for 80-20, but it's not really practical for a small shop to.
Once you've been doing it long enough, at least for me and some of the other guys in our facility, you can eyeball it, and you get really close. We actually play a game where we'll fat test it and see who gets closest, and they're making lunch. So
it's a sport in the Butcher Olympics, along with making a perfect, along with making a perfect 1-pound package of something.
It's a sport. Yeah. But normally what we do for most of the stuff in our packing facility is it's just ground beef. That means it can be anywhere from 30% and under. You can do the other, but I generally don't. It takes, like, for extra lean ground beef, you're cutting all this extra fat off and throwing it away. One, decreases your yield, and two, it takes a lot of time. And in our facility, time is money. Yep. So.
Yeah, that's good to know. I feel like I should wait too much.
Can you talk about the genetic difference between your first day grass-fed and grass-fed when you finish?
In our facility, we do mainly grass-fed. We do a lot of smaller producers that are basically, they raise it themselves, we process for it, co-pack it under their label, it goes back to them, and they can sell it however they choose. In that respect, I don't have much. I had one person that did it for a while. They were selling it mainly to restaurants. But, I mean, there was a lot more fat on it, and we were cutting it off and throwing it away, which is kind of sad, but is what it is.
Yeah.
But
we see, as you said, for some reason, there's a lot of demand for grass-fed grind, but people, and grass-fed fillet, but people get turned off by grass-fed anything else.
Is it because of the taste?
No, I don't know why.
It's rounder, right?
It's a darker color, usually. It looks a little leaner sometimes, but not always. In the middle of the summer, it can look just as good, if not better, than. And we don't really do grain finish. They get a little bit of grain their entire lives, but they never have like a huge finishing.
It's not conventional beef, is what you're saying.
Right. We don't have conventional beef. So also in our case, the difference between the 100% grass and the pasture raised that gets some grain is not that big. There is a difference, especially in the winter, but because we're in the Northeast, out in Oregon, you don't have as much of a difference, because you can do grass fed year round. It's not as stark contrast in the winter.
But isn't there? In my experience, and we've had this conversation when we did the event at Butchery's with the James Beard Foundation. It's also chefs aren't trained to cook grass fed.
Right, it cooks different,
and it's a completely different cooking process. Mm-hmm. So if you've eaten a non-burger or a what was the other cut you said that is really popular with grass-fed?
Oh, fillet. Just fillet.
Right, if you've eaten a porterhouse or whatever that has been grass-fed, it might not have been cooked properly. So that might be why the customer says, oh, I don't think that's very good.
Yeah.
So there's a kind of a small, hopefully quickly growing movement in culinary schools to train around different kinds of meat. Not only beef, but also pork and lamb, et cetera, for the different growing practices and the different diets that these animals have had, because it's not all the same.
Well, and in fact, the American Grass-Fed Association,
In fact, the American Grass-Fed Association's founding executive director is a chef. And that was something that was paired with that organization wanting to create a certification for producers and promote grass-fed, but also to really focus on the cooking part, because that was really lacking in culinary training, absolutely. I wanted to ask a question about freezing technology, because this is the kind of thing that has really worked in the seafood industry, Flash freezing is a science, and almost no one can tell the difference between fish that can't, you know, fresh fish and frozen but thawed well. But we talk a lot about, well, grass-fed is seasonal. It doesn't, it's very difficult to bring it, you know, 100% of the time off the pasture in a lot of places. And wouldn't it be great if we could get more people to accept buying frozen meat? Now, if you buy bulk, you buy it frozen. But restaurants regularly, and Ben mentioned this before, you know, oh, I get too much of a puddle. And I don't know if that's your particular problem with it, but that's something I've heard from chefs is if I thaw meat, I just get this puddle out of it, you know. Where are we with having decent enough freezing technology, especially at the processing plant, where that's not going to be an issue as much, and we could actually work with more seasonal production but spread it out in terms of marketing over the year? What do you think?
Yay. Now, our farm in particular does a lot of fresh cuts. But yeah, we call it purge, at least in our facility, where it's just that. Yeah, that puddle left in the bag. I notice it more in the dense areas, so like the Round, sometimes even near New York will get that purge in it. So as far as making it easier, I'm not quite sure, but most of what we don't doesn't go out fresh. I do flash freeze, and I notice it doesn't quite get as much of that purge out of it, but I'm not quite sure. But the other thing too is we also do a shrink film that's immediately frozen as well, and that does kind of purge, so I don't know if it's the backpack or the shrink wrap. So.
We like air. We find that the exposure to air, it makes a difference in the texture and how the steak cooks. So, you know, when someone says leave a steak out in your refrigerator before you cook it, it's because the refrigerator is a natural, the cold air is a desiccant and it's drying the surface, so you get a harder sear on it. You know, if you're gonna, we vacuum seal stuff at our central commissary, send it to the shops, and we get the purge, even without freezing it, you're gonna get the purge by sealing it in a vacuum bag for any amount of time. And then I think for us, an important step to getting that quality back is the fact that we slice it into steaks and then it sits in a cold air case until somebody buys it. I don't know much about the freezing, but I just know every time you put something in a vacuum seal bag, you are decreasing the textural quality of the steak. That's what I've personally found in our business, but.
There are ranchers actually in Oregon here that have done tests to show the difference, like the first 21 days of dry aging is to lower the moisture content by that first 7% or more if you have a better facility. And there have been tests done by certain ranchers where they'll flash freeze for 24 hours and then thaw, and you'll get that same moisture loss. So in the terms of concentrating flavor, you can see a lot of benefits, but it does affect the texture. And the most important part is when you thaw it, don't thaw it in the bag because it's going to be trapped in with that purge. So if you want to thaw it and you want to see the benefits without the drawbacks, then you thaw it somewhere where that water can be evacuated, and you're going to get, you know, the drying, and you'll basically, what you're doing when you freeze is all the water that's in there is turning into crystals, and most of it won't be reabsorbed. It's going to be loose. The longer it stays in the vacuum bag after it's been thawed, you know, water and bacteria are necessary for one another, you know. So the longer it sits in there, the more available water there is for any bacteria, and so any off flavors that are going to be created are just going to be concentrated. So I think if you are going to freeze, the most important thing is teach people how to treat it afterwards. Like when you guys cut it open, I'm sure you don't just throw the bags in the walk-in and let it sit there. You know, you get them out and you portion them, or you let them rest because you want to give it time for all that available water to evaporate and be driven away.
Well, and one more thought about that. I mean, on the one hand, I think the freezing is really important for folks in terms of marketing. If, you know, all their animals are coming off at a certain time, and what are they going to do? They can't sell all of that fresh already. But it's also true that from the processor's perspective, you don't want to process everything at the same time. So what you're looking for is people to extend their seasons and bring animals in, not just in the fall, but in the dead time when everyone says, oh yeah, you think I'm hard to get into? Nobody's calling me anymore, you know? So if we can extend seasons, so there's definitely give and take here. Other questions for folks?
Patty, I have a question. Do you have a slow season since producers can produce year round here?
Yes, we do have a slow season. It's actually January, February, and sometimes March. Now that farmers markets are actually kind of extending their seasons around here, it kind of hasn't slowed down as much as I would like to have a vacation. But it is nice to keep the plant busy. We do have employees, and I like to keep them busy. I actually have a nice group of packagers that are part-time that are retired, and this is their retirement job. Nice. And so they're willing to take some time off in the slower seasons. They have grandkids they love to play with. But seasonality is huge. Even our scheduling, starting like in April through June is generally, you better be calling me in March to schedule during that time. When farmers market starts, that's when we get busy. And then the other really busy season that I generally book out, sometimes as early as August, is October, November, December. And what part of it is, yes, that's the season that most people butcher in, as well as we have federal holidays that we have to take off. You got Columbus Day, Veterans Day, Thanksgiving, and then then you get two more back-to-back, Christmas and New Year's. So we're scheduling around that, and everybody gets sick that time of year too, which makes it fun. But at the same time, but yeah, we do try it. We do a lot more people that process year-round. They go every week, they go every other week, they go once a month, and I just schedule them accordingly, which is actually my main job, so.
Processors love those kinds of customers.
I do. That's actually right now I had two people. They're like, oh, anytime. I said, how about January? That'll work. Okay, good. I don't need to schedule you for December. For us, we're just a processor, so I also have to coordinate with the slaughter facility we use, and they're also do processing for themselves. So there's kind of a coordination piece, too, of we have to make sure we get the slaughter lined up and it fits into our schedule. I always tell people, earlier is better. I have a lot of people that starting in January, they book out the entire year for them. I actually have like five of them that I have on the email.
Individual farmers who you're working with, so you're not doing slaughter, you're working with a slaughter facility for that. Who's transporting between?
We do.
Okay.
So, yeah, and then I actually handle all of the financials. So basically you drop the animal off at them, We pick it up, I handle the cutting instructions, and then you ultimately pick it up from our facility.
So you take ownership at the slaughterhouse?
Correct. Okay. Well, we don't actually own the animal, right. It's the person's.
They take possession.
We take possession.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I have a question. One of the things I happen to know about Fleischers is that they're very much working on increasing the vertical integration of their supply chain to the retail store. And in doing so, you're working with farmers all over New York State and Pennsylvania and probably West Virginia and a couple of other states. And what is it like to have a conversation with a livestock producer that expresses interest in learning how to raise their animals a little bit differently because of either they're very interested in that, they've become interested in grass, they're interested in sustainability, they want higher value for their animals. Can you talk about that transition phase? How does it go?
Yeah, so where we've arrived is that we have a set of standards. We have a standards protocol that we have written up that says, basically number one, that the animal has to be outdoors its entire life, outdoors on pasture. And then has certain stipulations about if they are getting grain, what percent of their diet it can be, and so we have this list of standards, and you know, no unnecessary antibiotics. We're not, never, ever. We allow the animals to be treated if they get sick, provided they go through withdrawal period, and so we basically we work with a woman who is involved with the. NELPS, it's called in New England, and she, Kathleen Harris, helps us. She kind of introduces us to farmers, and she says, hey, this is a farmer who's interested in learning more about what you do. And we basically present them with our standards, and we say, these are the kinds of animals we're interested in buying. We are not experts in farming, we are experts in selling. We have the market, we have people who come to us and they trust us because the Fleischer's name stands for XYZ. If you're interested in selling to us, this is what it needs to be. We're happy to work with you to get there, but we're not going to tell you how to raise your animals. And so sometimes the initial reaction is, you know, I'm not there yet, no thanks. But then we also, you know, it's not for nothing. We offer a price advantage. We have a price collar. We offer more than they can get anyplace else a lot of times for the beef. And we also
provide some protection in case the market goes really low, as it has recently, and people are just, if we didn't have that collar, they would just hold on to their animals until the market got better. So we don't want to peg it too much to the market either. So in any case, we basically say, these are our standards. If you'd like to be one of our providers, we're happy to talk. And then it starts from there. But I think the key is to tell them that we represent the demand side, the selling side, not the farming side, but that this is what people are asking for. And so,
and we actually kind of came, we were farmers. My husband's family owns a beef farm. I actually was part of the pork farm that sold under our line, which is Lonely Lane Farms, and we ended up getting married, so it worked out pretty well. But we started with that. We were using another processor, and we actually kept running into the same bottlenecks as we need this product to go to this location, and no, we can't do that, sorry, we don't have time. There was quality issues too, as far as they weren't cutting it the way we wanted to. Any other cut you can take out of the beef, you can make more money, you know, that kind of stuff. So we had that, and finally he and I sat down one day and said, you know, this is really stressing us out. And so we decided to go the route of opening our own USDA processing facility. It was quite a steep learning curve. We're farmers who became butchers and running a whole USDA packing facility. So we've actually integrated everything. It's fun to see the calf born. It's raised on our farm. We've run it through, and you can kind of see even genetic differences and that kind of stuff. So that's kind of where we came from, and it's really interesting. The only piece we don't have is the slaughter, but it's not my favorite part, so I'm advocating against that.
Well, let me just add. So part of the story is when Mike and Patty started this cut and wrap facility, their plan, they worked it out financially so that they knew if they were only processing their own stuff, they could break even. They'd have to do all the work themselves. And I remember Mike saying to me, if I can process other people's stuff, then I can hire an employee. And I have the guy in mind. But, you know, they knew what they could do. So it wasn't that farmers ran out and said, you know, well, we're going to be able to afford this huge capital investment based on if we build it, they will come and maybe it'll be us. I mean, they had penciled out that they knew they could cover their nut. And then this question about adding slaughter, people have been asking them to add slaughter almost ever since they opened the plant. But, you know, they're just saying, I'm not sure that we can make it pencil out. That's a really expensive piece of the business. So, you know, we'll see what happens. Stay tuned.
We actually did pencil it out here recently, and we both went, well, just with the current slaughter prices in the area, it was not financially feasible at this time. But yes, we did. I actually do our books, and so I'm constantly looking at numbers. And we did hire that one guy, and he is still around, and along with about 9-10 other people. So we keep ourselves busy.
Why do your customers want you to be also doing the slaughtering?
I think to have it all under one roof. It's easier, too, when you can drop. I think it's a little bit more of a scheduling thing, too, because it takes me a little bit longer to schedule you because I got to check with the kill floor and get back to you. The other thing, too, is you just go into one facility, which is a lot easier. If you say, okay, I'm dropping off my animals today, and I'm going to pick up my product while I'm here. I think that's part of it. I think people trust us a lot to do, because you are trusting us with an animal you raised, you know, sometimes from birth, and so there's a lot of, I took good care of this, I want my processor to take good care of it too. And so I think that trust level is there.
Well, that's one of the reasons I'm asking, because in New York, which is where we've done a lot of our beef, our livestock work, there is some great concern about how animals are treated at the slaughterhouse.
And that feeds a lot into quality as well. There's in the Danforth book, actually, there's a really good description of what can happen either if the animal is held for a long time and stressed out over a very, you know, days, like if they're not slaughtered within the appropriate amount of time, how the pH of the meat will go up, and that leads to dry, dense, kind of dark meat. And then there's the other end of the spectrum, which is if they are terrified right in that minute, right before they're slaughtered, then their pH drops, and then you get this kind of like watery, pale, like it kind of, the meat pulls away from the fat when you see it on the butcher shop side. So, you know, that having a calm animal throughout its entire life is essential to having really good meat. And if that, we work with, I think only, yeah, we're only AWA slaughterhouses at this point.
And in Oregon, your options are quite limited on who does slaughter. It's not exactly a glamorous job. It's not fun by any means, and it doesn't pay a whole lot. So it's hard to recruit into the industry and keep people there.
Is there a reason that you don't have slaughter yet?
When we were really frustrated with the processing, that was the part that we needed the most, was the processing. The other thing too was financial. When we opened, there was a lot of slaughter capacity in Oregon, but there wasn't a lot of processing capacity. Now it's kind of swinging the other way. There's a lot more processing available. There's a couple more plants that have opened in Oregon, most of which were farmers who also needed processing. So it's kind of their direction that we went.
Would you mind sharing financially what it costs?
To do like a beef or to do a processing facility?
Yeah, your whole processing.
What's your annual or your monthly expense?
No, where did it start?
The startup.
The startup part.
For us, it was actually quite gradual. The processing facility we were using before didn't have very good equipment. The processing facilities are just expensive to run. Yeah. The equipment's expensive. The return is really slow. So it's hard to, you have to really be invested in it. So we actually had a lot of the equipment when we opened our facility, and we still use it today. We've actually added more to it, but it's always a gradual step. I was actually in college when we started this route, so Mike did a lot more of the financials, and then I kind of came on a little bit later into it. So I'm not quite sure what we spent to start it up, but it is a huge investment, and I think to do it, you have to have another motive besides money to do it, quite literally.
Well, it was important. It was critical for their business at the time.
It is.
I mean, I think the other thing about slaughter is, in my experience, looking at this issue for, I don't know, 15 years or something, the times that I have gotten the most phone calls, I guess I'm supposed to use the mic, the times I've gotten the most phone calls from people saying, there aren't enough slaughter facilities in our place and we need to do a feasibility study to do a new one. It's always in January and February, right after the busiest time that was really hard, especially if producers didn't understand that they needed to call a few months in advance to get a slot. And that's when we hear it the most. And, you know, I've been thinking a lot about, you know, slaughter is really hard, and the only way you make any money on it is by the drop. You know, it's really hard to, because a lot of the plants that are around are depreciated out and they don't end up charging that much. And if you build a brand new facility, you're going to have to charge more for slaughter, which is going to push people away because they want the cheapest slaughter, right? So maybe we need to think about how can we find some economy of scale in the drop, which is really hard for, it turns into a liability at a small scale plant. But if you could, the reason that the big, massive big meat plants make money is not the sale of the meat, it's the sale of the drop. So, although I guess that's getting better. But anyway, I think that we need to find some solutions to slaughter. And I'm not saying small slaughter plants aren't important. They're absolutely important, and they've been absolutely critical to the growth of the local food movement, and they need to continue. But in some places where we're trying to deal with capacity crunches, we need to think about, could we afford a slightly bigger, maybe more regional plant that maybe other, some cut and wraps can share the use of? I don't know, it's just kind of a big, fat, hairy, audacious idea or whatever they call that. But I feel like we have to think about how to solve that problem.
And that, like, that's very valid. The processing, the slaughter floor we use, like they have their own processing, and they kill for us and them, and they still have excess days occasionally, but he uses the same crew, it's a long story. But the other thing too is the processing facility for us, Century Oak, breaks even, and Mike and I live off of our farm. So that's the whole goal of Century Oak, is it's supposed to be just a processor for other smaller farms and ranches, and it has to pay its own bills. And if it breaks even at the end of the year, I'm ecstatic.
I have a question about the scale of farm that works with, I think primarily with you two, because Patty, your facility, it sounds like, you know, I could bring in just a cow from my backyard potentially and work with you. But like you mentioned, working with a rancher who has 300 to 500 head. Before you started working with that rancher, how were they selling all of their animals? Because you said you absorb like 98% of their.
Yeah, so we're fully committed to all the beef. I think one every other month goes out to one other customer. Before that, they were in a marketing pool, so they were part of the Country Natural Beef Program,
okay,
which is a sort of a marketing.
It's a co-op.
And at the time, there were only, I think, 30 ranches involved, and now it's, I mean, it's a lot bigger, but he was marketing through there and then also marketing some of his animals through a local grass-fed co-op that markets to one of the grocery stores. And he started looking at the numbers and realizing if I direct marketed, I could get a lot more. And also my beef is consistently the best in every pot I put it into. So his was the best beef going into that, you know, every lot of Country Natural. And then the same thing with the grocery. He was being lumped in with six other ranches in that grocery store. And every time he went in, he could tell that's definitely from one of my beef. So he decided to go direct market and started knocking on doors and realized that there's a big trade-off. Now, you know, he used to have he'd hook up his gooseneck and he'd run animals off and sell them in a lot, and they'd go into a back lot and finish through a program. Now he drives every Wednesday and drops off beef at the processor. The next morning he goes back up with his trailer and picks up beef that's coming up to us 2 weeks later and drives it all the way here. I mean, he's got two solid days that are spent just getting his beef to process and then to market, where it's great for us because we're really dedicated and we can handle his volume. So I get an hour every week where I get to just sit here and talk while Chris unloads the beef from the truck. I sit here and talk with him about what's going on, and that's very romantic, but it's not, every rancher in Oregon couldn't possibly do that. Like, I mean, obviously you've got to have other things, you know, going on.
I guess in closing, again, I will say this is not, the way that we just broke this down is a way that I hope kind of helped explain the different options you have for when you're breaking down a four quarter of beef. There's the entire, you know, three other quarters that we didn't do, or I guess there's the hind quarter we didn't get into at all. But the chuck is really interesting. It's one of my favorite parts. And while it might not have been the most efficient break in the world, hopefully it gave you a good idea of what you can do with it. But I will definitely emphasize, I mean, it's great to hear you talk about the numbers and making it work. I mean, at the end of the day, I say I don't butcher every day anymore. I haven't butchered every day in 2 years probably, but at the end of the day, it's a business, right? And so it's very romantic to focus on the butchery aspect, and everybody always wants to learn more, and that will definitely make you a better marketer and a better seller to know how everything fits together and what your options are. But if you know, Fleischer's has 100 employees right now, so at the end of the day, you also have to have a very functional business, and the numbers have to work, the people have to work, you know, the technology has to work, and it all has to be there. So for those of you who are looking to start businesses of your own around meat, I would say my advice is, like, learn enough about the butchery to be dangerous, but unless you're doing it every day, there are also all kinds of other skills which are equally, if not more important to making it work, right?
I actually have a degree in accounting, so yes.
Yeah.
do either of you have a recommendation for the farmers in the room?
I would say get recommendations. I mean, all processors and all slaughterhouses are not created equal, and we have really struggled to find processors and slaughterhouses that we can trust to, I mean, things as simple as giving you back the animals that are yours, that's can be a problem. So I think that word of mouth recommendations are huge, and listening to your customers too, because the way that I have cut this, I mean, I asked Ben when I came here, I was like, you tell me what I should and shouldn't do, because your customers are not my customers. So it's very important to know who you're cutting for and make sure that you serve that market.
The one thing I actually tell new customers of ours is cut it how you would be excited to sell it, because ultimately you're going to be the one selling it. So if you're not excited about it, your customers are going to pick up on that. A lot of times, cut it how you're going to cook it as well, because you'll give out a lot of cooking advice to a lot of different people. So just be excited about what you choose.
Okay, closing statement. So I want to say two things. One is, it's always really exciting for me to be in a room with lots of people who are different parts of the supply chain, right? Either within it in terms of the businesses or without it, like I am, trying to help support those businesses. So the reason that I and Arian Taboomery, who says hi, by the way, co-founded MPAN almost 10 years ago. And just a side note, Arian, when we started it, we were both PhD students, or I was just finishing, and now he runs the Vermont Packing House in Vermont, which is an incredibly successful slaughter and processing facility, and amazingly transparent and an incredible model. You know, we started as a way to share information. So everyone has a card. You know, you can go to the website. If you have questions about processing, butchering, any of these things, you should join our listserv. You are absolutely free to ask and answer questions that come out there. And sometimes I think there's not anybody, you know, there are a few people asking, and then I get all these people saying, I lurk, I learn. There's so much going on here that's so valuable to me. So please become part of that conversation. Ben, would you like to close us out?
I will add that I cannot say enough good things about MPAN as well. I mean, having recently converted our central commissary to a USDA inspected facility, I mean, it's not, I'm not overstating it by saying we could not have done it without an MPAN. So,
and the same thing for us, working on taking over a USDA facility. I mean, there's a level of regulation and then a level of code that's really inaccessible to laymen, even people who have been within the industry. And then also, so much of the information within the industry is proprietary, and so people aren't willing to share HACCP plans or things that they've done to find solutions. And having a resource where you can go and at least discuss, people may not hand you all of their HACCP plan, but you know, they'll at least discuss ways that they've found resolution. What you said is the best. Any chance that you've got to bring people from different parts of the chain together, I mean, that's how there are these big leaps in solutions that are found when you get people together to talk about these ideas. And we were really just excited to host you guys. I mean, not only to bring the East Coast out here and to get the chance to talk a little bit, but also, you know, to host a really cool group. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen.
Thank you,
everybody. Thank you, Karen.
For making this a really important talk.